first of all, a very warm welcome to all of you, also to you on the web. I've been asked to do this talk in English because this is not only for my Scandinavian readers, but for the readers in the 25 other countries where my books are published. So bear with me. And if there is a word or anything that suddenly disappears, please help me. All right? I'm often being approached by people who in some way have misunderstood what religion really is. Lars, you are a religion person. How can you believe in God when you look around in the world and you see people are starving and everybody's killing each other? And religion is the root to all evil. I said, I don't think so. I don't think that it is religion. I think it's those people who are dealing with religion that have misunderstood something. And I think if you don't believe in God, you need to tell me how you define God, because that is crucial in order to understand what it is you don't believe in. Yeah, but I don't believe in an old man up in the sky. Okay, I said, welcome in the club, because neither do I. What do you mean? What do you believe in then? It dawned on me many times that people who comes and tell you that they don't believe in God haven't really thought about what they think when they are talking about God. In some way, they are stuck with their childhood perception of what God is. So then, of course, the conversation goes on, and he asks him, what do you mean by God? And I said, the best ever explanation of God I ever heard was actually from a physicist called Max Planck in 1944. He said that it was his experience that behind everything created, there were a creative, intelligent force ruling everything. And I think that's the best explanation of God I ever heard. And actually, most of you or my readers know that I've been working with the Aramaic language, the language of Yeshua and Mary Magdalene. And to me, this is key to the scriptures. Without the understanding of what the Aramaic language really can do for us when we want to see behind what is behind the scripture, Aramaic is crucial, no doubt about it. And when I discovered what was really hidden in there, for example, just take the quote from Yeshua in the Gospel of Luke. It goes like this: remember, the kingdom of heaven is inside of you. Kingdom of heaven is inside of you. It's not someplace somewhere. It's something inside of you. It's a state of being. And that makes the whole difference. The funny thing is that I, as a Christian, born as a Christian, raised as a Christian, and the same goes for you, I bet you have never ever heard any preacher preach about the kingdom of heaven being inside of you. And it makes a whole lot of difference. Because instead of projecting things out, we are projecting inwards. And through the inner kingdom in us, we project in the direction of God. If you see it this way, if we as creation are projections of what we call the creative force, the heavenly source or God or whatever you can call this force anything. Jack Jones, Mary Williams, Allaha. XA 400 something. It doesn't matter really, because it's just words. The force stay the same. Spirit is spirit, whatever you call it. So we need to understand in order to practice and to really use the gifts that we have been given. We need to have everything reorganized. Religion really comes from the Latin religare, and that means to reconnect. And just by thinking about what reconnect means, it means that we have been connected. At some time we were connected, but now we are disconnected. Therefore we have to reconnect to the source. So that was what is that's what religion really is all about, to reconnect to the source, to the creative force. When you open the scriptures, we are told that we were created in the image of God. If you take the Aramaic approach, you will find out that this is a metaphor that we were given a part of that creative force are the most important part of us. But we are in some way too much caught up in physical life and in being physical individuals that we forget much too easy that we are spirit first, psychic then, and bodies of physic last. While we are incarnated, this is the hard part, because it's more or less a tragic state of being a human being, because we are here, we are caught up in a body, and we have all these gifts, but then how do we unfold them? How are we, what is prayer all about? You know, when I talk about prayer to people who have never prayed or don't know anything about it, they look at me as I come from some ancient time, you know, back from, and as I'm a primitive kind of creature. But really, if you understand what prayer really is all about and how things go, if you let's take the, if you just think again about the kingdom of heaven being something inside of us. If you take the Aramaic word for kingdom of heaven, Malkuta Deshem Aya. Malkuta meaning kingdom. Deshem Aya, heavenly. But there is a root word hidden inside the word Deshem Aya. Shem is actually that light that Yeshua is talking about in the Gospels that should never be hidden underneath a bushel. This is the light that we need to draw from within and put up on the highest mountain so everybody can be enlightened by it. Shem is also that word that in the Gospel of John we can read, in the beginning there was the word, and that word was Shem, and by that everything was created. So Shem is actually the, you could call the key of life. This is the essence of life that we are carrying within us, everybody. The most beautiful thing about it is if you take De Shem Aya, that ending Aya means in Aramaic that is forever, which is forever. So this principle is the what is eternal in us. And just think about it, how beautiful it is that we are being told that the kingdom of heaven is within us, and that kingdom carry the root word Shem, which is the key of life. This is the spark of life. In the Gospel of Thomas that was found in Nakamadi in Egypt in 1945, we can read, the kingdom of heaven is within you and everywhere around you. So we are actually already here in heaven, if we choose to, because you must remember, why is the world in the shape it is today? It's the result of all the choices, all the wrong choices we made. It has nothing to do with God. We were co-creators. We were giving this big responsibility and gifts at the same time to be co-creators, and we have completely missed it. So that is why we have to reconnect. You remember when you were children, when we were childs, we were. You remember those pieces of paper with small dots and numbers, and we could draw a line from 1 to 2 and 2 to 3 and 3 to 4, and suddenly, by magic, an image appeared. We were reconnecting the dots. And that's exactly what we are doing when we are working with spiritual work, when we are doing prayer, meditation, whatever. Anything spiritual is about connecting the dots. And when we start this work, in the beginning, it has all to do with connecting the dots within us. Because we are completely reconnected from our own source, first of all. So that's where we start. And by prayer, what is prayer? For example, if we sit here now together and we want to pray for somebody on the other side of the globe, what is really happening? We are carrying, you and I and everybody else are carrying this state of being within us, this precious pearl of life called Kingdom of Heaven. And this is the kingdom that is completely, there's no noise, there's no ego, there's no suffering, only stillness, compassion, and consciousness, pure consciousness about who you are. When you reach that point in you, the Kingdom of Heaven, you can do almost anything. We can move mountains by that. It says actually in the Gospel of Mark, if you have faith, anything is possible. So in the beginning when I read this, I thought, if you have faith, anything is possible. But how can you have faith in anything if you don't know what it is? Is this blind faith? Until I discovered the Aramaic word for this. And it's, you know, when you unfold the Aramaic language, it is like you have not just one word or one meaning for each word. There is 7, 8, 9 different words. In almost any other language, if you have 2 meanings for the same word, when you are talking about one thing, you the other one is discouraged, you know, or what do you call it? It is excluded, or and vice versa. In Aramaic, when you every word with 7 or 8 different meanings that can be completely diverse, you need to take everything into consideration. You cannot separate one from the other. And that, of course, you are, it's a complete new way of perception. That is why Yeshua is saying, almost for everything he says, he said, let those who have ears hear and those who have eyes see. He's always referring to, listen to what I say. There is a hidden meaning behind this. There's a broader meaning behind everything I say. Don't take the word face value. Take it in and let it work. So that's how this language really works. So blind faith is really, it means that kind of insight that we that everybody is carrying around without knowing it, just awaiting to be activated. Yes? So prayer is actually to activate something that we already got. We don't need anything from outside. We are carrying everything within us. Everything. Anything you need is there already. So actually, if you went into the old mystery school, for example, of the Essenes, where Yeshua had his education, the Essenes that were living at Carmel Mountain in Israel or by the Qumran at the Dead Sea, and you invited them out in a, listen, friends, we have a rocket outside, we want to go to the moon, do you want to come with us? They would be really estranged from what you were saying. They wouldn't understand what are you talking about. What why would you like to go there? Because they knew already what we are just trying to understand today, that what is out there is already here. What is not here doesn't exist anywhere else. So instead of going out into deep space to look for is there life out there, they would rather say is there life on Earth? Because sometimes you can doubt that there is life here. We are just like zombies going around. We need to wake up. We need to reconnect. And the beautiful thing to this story is that we already are given the gift to do it. So if we, for example, want to help somebody on the other side, on the other side of the globe, for example, the seer that was my teacher, and I sat beside him every morning for years, just watching him work. And for a long time, I had no idea of what was going on. How could he connect to somebody who was on the other side of the globe and have a completely clear view of that person? Because he was connecting. He was connecting the dots, you see. When we send a prayer somewhere, we don't really send it anywhere. The potential for healing is already there. Why? Because we have heard the kingdom of heaven is inside you and everywhere around you. Just for a moment, just for a minute, think what Max Planck told us. There is an intelligence force behind everything created. That intelligence is everywhere, just awaiting that we connect to it. It's like electricity. It has always been there. I once heard somebody said, oh yeah, human beings have really, we discovered electricity. No, we didn't discover electricity. It was already there. We found out how to connect to it and use it so that we have got electric light. Fantastic. No doubt about that. But we forget because in our times, we are so caught up in technology. Yeah, we forget the technology of the soul. We forget that we can, every time we turn on a GPS, we are in fact undermining our own integrity as human beings. We are completely wasting our time on technology that we could actually do much better by the faculties that we were given from when we were born. So a lot of people they come to me and say, ah, how can that be? We pray a little prayer and something will happen somewhere. If you have never tried it, how can you say that it doesn't work? So there's only one thing to do, is to get some experience doing it. I can tell you a lot of things about how this works. And you might believe me, or you said maybe, or you said the man is crazy. And you're completely right. I am crazy. But if you have a notion that this could be something that you wanted to try out, try it. Because my experience works for me. And what I have seen and experienced, nobody can come and say, you haven't experienced that. What do I care? I know what I have experienced, what I've seen. I know. So it doesn't matter what everybody else said. Go and experience something yourself. Start practicing, start praying, and see how it works. Connect the dots. It's free. It doesn't cost anything. Just a little time, 5 minutes, 10 minutes, or whatever, sit down and do it. But how are we doing this? You need to start to, I think in the beginning it would be very, very helpful to just with a loud voice start talking to yourself. And if you think that's too awkward, do it silently. But sometimes go and find a space on your own and nobody hears you, and just start talking to that force that is all around you or within you. And you will discover that slowly, if you are persistent, and this is something that is really, what do you call it, something that we really need to work with. Because a lot of people here in our part of the world are not used to keep up a daily practice. We need, what do you call it, discipline in order to keep up. We give up if there's no results immediately, we give up. I've been doing a Buddhism for a week and it doesn't seem to work, so now I try Taoism for a few days just to see how that works. But you know, you should remember, people who are working with this, actually now they're sitting 5,000 males on Mount Athos praying for the world. And once they were visited by a television crew from Germany, and one of the interviewers asked this monk, I mean, it's so touching to experience that you are praying here for the world, but when we look around in the world and see how everything goes, it doesn't seem to work, he said. How do you think the world would look if we didn't do it? Yeah. That was his answer. Brilliant answer, because that's exactly how it is. If you knew how many people right now that they are giving all their time to this task, trying to keep balancing the world. The seer was one of these people. He didn't pray in that classical sense of the word, but he was right from the morning, from the beginning, he raised up and he said, I hereby dedicate myself to the universe, to compassion and to healing. So this was something that he kind of started a vibration all around him just by saying it out loud. And we that were his students, he wanted us to do exactly the same, and we had to say it out loud. And in the beginning it's very awkward, you know, to I hereby and every evening he sat down on his bed and he was just going through the day and just recapitulating how the day was going. If he thought that he could done something better, he tried the next day to sharpen up. And we can do the same. I mean, it doesn't cost anything, just to be present. Another special thing about when we are talking about the Aramaic language is that just think about that in the time of Yeshua, Christianity wasn't even invented. Yeshua had never heard anything about Christianity. And sin, one of the most crucial words, center words in Christianity, sin, it doesn't even exist in Aramaic, in the language of Jesus. So what does it mean? It does mean to miss the mark. If you are an archer, for example, and you are standing and you are trying to hit bull's eye and you miss the mark all the time, what do you do then? You go a little bit closer to the target. You are not present. And if you are not present in everything you do, you miss the mark, you miss the target in everything you do. You really need to be there, 100%. And of course, we cannot be there 100% all the time. But when you are working with prayer, when you're working with spirituality, when you're working with healing or whatever, you put this is me. This is really what I was born for. Then you must go all in. Whatever, it doesn't matter what the norms say or what. If they are standing out there on the sideline and pointing fingers at you and saying, he's crazy, she's crazy. Forget it. We need to be 100%, invest everything if we want to succeed, and if we want to connect to the dots, we need to be all in and be there 100%. So, when we start to really understand how these things work, you will. I mean, when you understand it, it's like, why didn't they tell? Why didn't somebody tell me that this was so simple? Because nobody knew. Nobody have told them. And we are living in a time where it seems that everything is being more and more black and white each day. There's more and more people working with these things, taking the first steps on this path. But there is also darker powers that is pulling in the other direction. And it is like something must come to an end and to a new beginning. And it looks like it's all happening in our time. So that is why the more people who understand this and are willing to give up careers and stuff, maybe careers that doesn't really lead to anything. I always think of Dalai Lama's words, we don't need more successful people, but we need healers, dancers, storytellers, and lovers. I totally agree. That's what is needed. Healers, restorers, storytellers, dancers, lovers, yes, welcome. So this is what I try to inspire people with in my books and in my work and when they come to workshops, that to be dancers and lovers and storytellers and healers. So this is really, we are the masters of our own lives if we choose to be. But of course, as soon as we leave communities like this or communions like this and go out in the world, it takes 5 minutes to get lost in the noise that we are surrounded by again and again and again. So that's why we need to keep up this discipline of practicing every day. And if we can keep up that, at some point, for some people it can take weeks, for others maybe years, others maybe days, you will have a breakthrough and something will open. That is why I love to use the metaphor of the broken heart, the wisdom of the broken heart, because only a broken heart is really whole. It is like when everything is kind of stagnated, when we are stagnated here, then there's no, when we are stuck here and there's no movement, then everything is like freezing to ice, you know, it's like, and there's no movement and there's no connection. So that is why when we incarnate in this life, we have a kind of or somebody wants to sell us the dream of happiness, and happiness is a new car and a new house. And of course, it's lovely to have a new car and a new house and 3 holidays every year and whatever. But you know all that this is only something that leads to new wishes and new cravings and stuff. In the end, we are left with the pain being incarnated, because actually we are souls incarnated in a body and we are caught up here, but for a reason. And it's very, very important to understand there is a reason. It's meaningful for us to be here right now, but we have to remember why we are here. Why we are here. That's crucial. In the silence, and in the space that each of us can create, free of noise, free of anger, free of pain, cravings, are us being co-creators of this world. And that is something that we really need to. We are the only ones who can actually do it in this incarnation. And if you don't do your part of it, don't expect somebody to come and do it for you, because it, there's only you who can do your bit. Because why? Because we have so much in common, everybody, but on some certain little thing, you have a special task that nobody can come and do for you. So that's why we have to wake up. And every time we are not listening, every time we refuse to see, every time we turn the back on ourselves, there's only pain, and we have to deal with all these things. So actually, every time a partner leaves us, we are fired from a job, maybe we are caught on sickness or anything, it's actually a gift from above, you could say. The pain is the messenger, and the message is wake up. That's the kind of world we're living in. So we really have so much to be grateful for. But what is happening? I'm stumbling over a stone, I fall down and hit my knee. I pity myself. I was lying on a bed for 3 years, praying to God. Dear God, tell me, please, what I have done wrong so I can clean up my act. But there was no answer. Of course not. Because I was lying there pitying myself. And I was just, you know, the biggest fool you could think of. Until one certain day, and this is after 3 years, just remember, every day for me was like, up there, I was in a mud hole, up there, there was light. So every day was like climbing up in order trying to get a hole up there, so I could, and every time I just slide it down again. And I had to wait till the next day to try again. And this went on for 3 years. And after 3 years, there was one day that there was something completely different happening. Instead of me trying to get up, suddenly I heard a voice saying, if you're lying here and feeling so much pain, more pain than you can ever describe, why are you not taking upon you the pain of other people who are suffering? Because then it's not meaningless lying there. Then it has a purpose. You have a purpose. You are actually freeing a lot of people by lying. And there was no doubt in my mind that when I heard it, I had to comply. I had to say yes. I didn't even think about it, because I knew somehow that if I didn't comply, I would never get another chance. This was my way out of this situation. A week later, I was connected to the seer, and I'm certain that there was a connection between my yes and being connected to the man I was supposed to connect. Had I said no, and this is what we all have to face, what do you say, yes or no? You have a choice. Everybody has a choice. And we have a choice every minute of the day. Every second, we are faced with that choice. What is it? Yes or no? So this was when, many years later, I understood, and this is of course without any comparison, I was thinking about when they try and tell us that Jesus was killed for or took upon him our sins. I thought there was something wrong with that. He took the responsibility for our lives upon him. So if that was so, what are we doing here? If he have taken responsibility for everything. No, we are here to take responsibility for each and one of us. Yes. What he was doing was maybe trying to tell, listen, everything has a purpose. And if you think that everything around you is meaningless, you are the one who can change all that. Anything is possible, but we have to make the right choice. And when you made that choice, go and practice in order to unfold it. Instead of just waiting for somebody to come around to do it, because what? Go and see the movie of the seer. And there is a special moment in that movie I love so much. Is that when he said, you don't have to learn to meditate. it takes half a minute, everyone can do it. But of course, when people come and say, I can't do this and I can't do that, I'm not allowed to do, it's not good, because then nothing can happen. We are the ones to do what exactly that what we came here for, to unfold our spirituality, to unfold what we have been. And sometimes also people, they ask, what kind of prayer could we use? And actually, you can go and you can buy prayer books, you can buy all the books in the world, but when it comes down to it, I mean, it would be the same if we wanted to go to the library and try to find a book that, in order to learn to ride a bike. There is not such a book. It doesn't exist. If you want to ride a bike, you cannot read about it. You need to hop on the bike yourself and start practicing. And that's exactly the same you have to do. The traffic rules you can read all about. And that is what spiritual books are here to inspire you and tell you. There is people who have gone this path before you. It doesn't matter if you want to walk the Buddhist path, the Taoist path, the Christian path, or whatever. They're actually talking about exact the same thing, all of them. And it's all for free. You don't need to go to workshops or to... When you understand that you have everything that you already need, you just need, how do we unfold it? Use your breath. The way of breathing is crucial also here. And it is in any tradition you would like to So, we are given everything we need. It's just a matter of us applying it to our everyday life. We talk too much about compassion. We need to be compassionate people. Anyone can stand up, as I'm doing now, and say anything. Words are really cheap. I mean, it is in the acts I'm doing, it is what I'm, how I live, that I can inspire other people, and it goes for everybody. And just open the television and we hear our politicians say one thing and doing a complete other. They're probably thinking of a third thing also. So there's no alignment at all. So this is another challenge to us, to create alignment within us, to create alignment between what we think, what we say, and what we do. Anything else is noise. Just think about it, and it's not easy. I agree, but that's how it is. So, how do we pray? Whatever you feel like is the right way to pray. Choose your own words. Heavenly Source, you who are here now, open up my heart and fill it with light. That could be a suggestion. If you want to pray for somebody, Heavenly Source, you who are everywhere, please open up the heart of Yen and fill it with light. You are connecting the dots and you are activating a potentiality that is already where you, what you're thinking about. It's everywhere. And it's just awaiting us to come and activate it. That is exactly how it is. Okay, I think we should continue to have a little session with questions, if you have any questions, and hopefully some very, very wise answers. All right? I won't promise anything, you know. And if there's something, what I've been trying to say here tonight, if there's anything that is...
We have a few questions from the web.
All right.
Just one, actually. There is one question from Ninette. And she would like to ask you, could you tell a little bit more about how to talk to yourself? She says she is using time in silence with herself, but how to talk to yourself?
There's one thing that I haven't even talked about here, but that is that we have a guardian angel, for example. And I know this is something that that is really, when you say such things, there's a lot of people say, okay, oh, he's one of those. Let him, take him to the asylum, please. But this is something that I have experienced with, that it's very, very important that we keep connected to the source within. And you can do that loud with a loud voice, or you can say it silently. Sit down and just commune with that. And in any prayer you can think of is actually listening inwards, to listen. For example, Heavenly Source, help me to understand this problem so I can solve it. Thanks, because it'll be so now, for example. That's a very efficient way of doing it, and it works. It's just a matter of, when in the beginning maybe it's awkward for somebody, you just need to keep on doing it, so you in the end you will come out in the other on the other side, and suddenly it'll become something that, oh, now I understand, because you can feel it, you know, you must experience it. Or else it's impossible for me to tell exactly how it will work for you, because no one have are experiencing the same thing. But I bet and I guarantee you something will happen that opens up to your heart. And that's what it's all about to me.
Hi, hello. Is it working? Okay. I was curious about what you spoke about at the end. Why does the Heavenly Source need humans to activate the potential? Why is it not directing itself towards Jan's heart and open it?
We are part of, if we take it from there, you go and you just read in the Old Testament. And we can come back to that. What is the Old Testament? What is that all about? But you can actually read there that we were created in the image of God. If you go in and take the Aramaic approach, you would see that that means actually that we are carrying this, that we are carrying this possibility within us to be co-created with God. So we are actually ambassadors of that creative force. In this world, remember that Yeshua also is saying somewhere in the Gospels that my Father's kingdom have many mansions. Yes, that means that we are not only incarnated here, we can incarnate on any level, on other planet systems, in other universes and so forth. I mean, there's life everywhere. And this is something that we are first here now coming, trying to understand that there is actually life out there. There's life everywhere. So we are an extension of that creative force. So you could also say we are the hands and feet of God or the angels here on earth. So God has, or that creative force has given itself the possibility of a yes or a no. Why? Because it's all about experience. We are here to experience things exactly as that source that we call God is. Another thing I need to tell you also here, because it in the Gospel of Philip, which was one of the Gospels that was found in Akamadi, we can read that the truth didn't come naked into the world, but came clothed in archetypes and symbols. And especially this quote is very important, because the language of the future will be archetypes and symbols. I mean, now I need a hell of a lot of words in order to explain all this, but there will come a day when you just need to see a symbol or hear a symbol or the sound of a symbol, and you'll understand exactly what's been talking. Because we are carrying a whole lot of archetypes and symbols within us that we have with us from other incarnations. And this is really what binds us together. I was fortunate to meet a moon priestess called Sylvia that I have read about in my book, The Grail. And she told me that she already learned to communicate this way many years ago when she was initiated as a moon priestess in France in 1961. And she said, this is the language of the future, where we are also connecting to fifth dimension, the way of fifth dimensional talk, a thought. So this is the next step kind of thing, you know. So, but we have to experience everything ourselves, or else we could just be a kind of, what do you call it, a theater thing or something, that for the amusement or for somebody somewhere, I don't know where. But good question. Thank you.
We have one more question from the net, and it's from Rana. How do you know that Shem is the first word?
It makes sense when you need to see the overall perspective when you're talking about Shem. Now I'm talking from the tradition that I have been studying and practicing for many, many years. Of course, if you go to a Buddhist tradition, they will talk about the same thing, but use another word or expression for that. Shem is within the tradition of the mystery schools of Mary the Magdalene and Yeshua, that word that is the creative force in everything. Shem. That's the only answer I can give you.
Hi. I would like to know how you get closer to your purpose in this life, or your assignment.
Yeah.
In this incarnation.
Very good question.
Thank you.
And this is a question I have met very often. The first thing I always tell people that ask me that question is, what do you feel like? I mean, is there anything that you really wish to do? Something that your heart really burns for? You can maybe be caught up in a place where you don't feel that you belong, or you can be in a family you don't feel you belong, or in a workplace or whatever. So the challenge for you is to break free of that situation and follow your heart. Follow your heart or fall, there is a saying. Actually, it's one of my old records that I call that. But at the time I thought it was very, wow. Later on, I found out it was really true, you know, follow your heart or fall. And this can be, of course, something that can be really challenging, because we can be in a situation where it can be very hard to break free of it. But you must try to listen inwards and feel, what do you feel like doing now? What would be the best thing for you to do if you had a free will, which you have? And go by that.
Do you get some signs when you're on your way?
Yes, of course. We are surrounded by signs from morning to eve, 24/7, for all our life. The only problem is that we don't see them. Let those who have eyes see, and those who have ears hear. And this is something that we need. It comes by practice, trying to be more present. But it is hard, because we are living in our times, we are living in situations where there is so much noise around us, and there are so many things that want to connect to us and buy this to be happy, you must buy this, you must have five of these and seven of these, and when we have done, and you must do this, or you're not right if you're not doing this, and so forth. We need to keep silent and just try to get away from that sometimes and listen to this one. Because there's, as the seer said, if you really want to find the best clairvoyant in your life, you are that clairvoyant. You are the only one who are carrying the right answers for you. So we need, again, to connect the dots, but in the right direction. Instead of projecting out, go in. So this is the answer. And it comes by practice. And if you don't know how, you just buy one of my books, The Law of Light, and you'll know all about it. I'm sorry to say that. But
we have a question from Dorte Larsen. Don't you have to ask a person before you pray for them? Because it might not be right for that person.
I have never met a person who didn't need a little prayer. None. As I have never, when people are talking about dysfunctional families, show me a family that aren't dysfunctional. I have never experienced it. So this is a, but I think it's a very good point to start at, you know, that we are here to correct things and to reconnect to the source. And you can do anything. The only thing is that if it hurts other people, of course you have to refrain doing it. But this also, you can, it's impossible to go through life without hurting someone. And there is a huge, what you would call, pedagogic reason for that. Because one day you are the victim, next day it's vice versa, and so forth. So we are each other's teachers and pupils. It just goes like this until we get the message. So of course you can pray for anybody that you know that needs help. And actually when I did, I was called to do a talk for some doctors in Aarhus who wanted to know more about healing, how it worked and so on. And I really had a day, really hard of work. How can I go about this without, you know, trying to keep it down to earth in order for these people to understand it? Because lots of those people are very like natural science fixated. So in the end, when there was questions and answers, one of the doctors said, Lars, what you are talking about, isn't that placebo effect? Yes, exactly. It is placebo. And how wonderful that is, that you can actually, if people believe that this prayer is working or this pill is working, there's no side effects or anything, and it's for free. And then it's all started there, you know, and then there was one of the female doctors who said, actually, that she had been together with other friends, been praying for a common friend that had cancer. Every night at 7 o'clock, they prayed for this man, without him knowing it. And he was only, they had given him something like 2 or 3 months to live in. But this was 7 years ago, and this man was still alive, and she was sitting there amongst her fellow doctors, saying she was convinced that it was their prayer who saved this man. So, by experience, trying to go and do it and see how wonderful things are being done by doing this. Of course, if you don't have pure intentions, because intentions are very important also. Why are you doing what you are doing? If you have impure intentions, it's black magic. And it will come back to you somehow. So of course we need to ask ourselves, and we can do that, and maybe it's tiresome in the beginning, but why am I doing what I'm doing? And sometimes people, they are just lying to themselves. Oh, I'm doing this, I'm working 80 hours a week, but I'm doing it for my family. Bullshit. We are talking about a man who doesn't want to be with his family. He's running away, you know. There's a microphone here. Yeah.
Hello.
Just send it. Yeah.
Is it? Okay. Yeah. I don't quite know how to formulate the question, but in your work, I've seen you working with the rising of the divine feminine, or how I understand it. And many times I'm sort of wondering if we have a little, like, different way of approaching God in being, like, female or male. Because for some reason we come into this world as males and females.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and I wonder if you have any thoughts upon that. Like, we also see a lot of gurus, and they tend to be men for some reason, and I don't see women in these positions as much as... Mm-hmm. Yeah. I don't know, is that clear?
Yeah, very, very, very good question, because it's a most important issue today about the male and the female. And in my work, I've discovered that this is the most important message from Yeshua and his bride and companion and equal friend in everything, Mary Magdalene. To me, those are... she is the first new woman, and he, Yeshua, is the first new man. And you know that a lot of attention have been given to those being the two of them being married, and it was all because of a quote from the Gospel of Philip that was found in 1945, where we can read that Mary the Magdalene was the disciple that Jesus loved the most and often kissed on the. And then there was a hole in the manuscript. Nobody knew really, but it gave thoughts to that those people had to be married. So all the attention had been given to those being married, Jesus being married to a woman, to a prostitute, and they having kids and everything. So we within this issue, we forgot all about the most important thing about it. Remember what Yeshua was really doing. He was giving away all the inside secrets of the mystery schools. He was giving it to ordinary people who couldn't read or write. And he was doing it in equality with the woman. And that was really why he was crucified, because that was completely forbidden. So when I think we can learn so much from those two archetypes, because they did everything in equality, and that is the challenge for us today, to try to recreate that equality, not from, I would say from any perspective, but foremost on a spiritual level. I know there's a lot of talk about the sexual thing, tantra and everything that's coming up, and that's of course is a very important part of this also, but I think we have completely misunderstood sexuality, which is really why the archetype of Mary the Magdalene have come in now, and he's still here and she's still misunderstood. So how do you define the masculine, and how do you define the feminine? That's the question. And to me now, when I'm talking about Yeshua, I'm always also talking about her. Every time I mention her, I am saying Mary the Magdalene. I'm actually also talking about him. You cannot. They are together from now on in my life. They are one. So that is why when you read the Gospel of Thomas, you read, when the male is not male anymore and the female are not female anymore, when they two become one, then you shall enter the kingdom of heaven. Mystical words. But just think about it. We are carrying within us a male and a female. It doesn't matter if you are female or male, we have both something. And there is in an old Aramaic gospel this saying that is very crucial to this. Just listen to this. It's Yeshua who's saying this. I and my bride are one, exactly as Mary the Magdalene whom I have chosen for myself as a type is one with me. It says everything. I and my bride are one, exactly as Mary the Magdalene, whom I have chosen to myself as an archetype is one with me. He's defining between a bride, Kalta in Aramaic, and Mary the Magdalene. What is he talking about? Kalta really means the feminine principle. So I and my feminine principle, which I have discovered within myself, is one. Exactly as Mary the Magdalene, whom is the mirror of that principle, is one with me. That is why I have chosen her as a teacher for me. So if they were working in equality, we have to understand that she have done exactly the same with him. She have chosen him because in him she saw and found the masculinity, the masculine principle within herself. They mirrored each other. That's why they can work in equality. The one without the other is only half. So this is what, it's no competition, if you understand. So that is why we have to, we are going through so much painful stuff when we are going into relationships. The masculine is the one who used to come home with the bacon, and the woman was the one who was ruling the home and stuff. And we have been changing all that, and now we have to go back to equality. Now today, a woman can actually be feminine and at the same time be prime minister, for that matter, you know. And males doesn't have to sit home knitting. Now males are cooking and are cleaning, and it's just a natural part of everything. So now we can actually forget all about all these everyday matters and keep concentrating on the real thing. How can we together take the next step? And of course, the sexuality. I never forget when Sylvia, the moon priestess, who had been working with these things for many years, and she said to me, there will come a time when a male and a female can actually make love on distance, and they can reach, they can manifest the light, the creative light, wherever they want to create it. They can, by their lovemaking on an ethereal level, they can actually connect the dots anywhere. They can make things happen everywhere. And I cannot stop thinking about when some of the rabbis in Israel are asking their some from their congregations, a man and a wife, to go into the bridal chamber as often as possible to mate. It is because they know that when a man and a woman enters the bridal chamber, and they are conscious about what they are doing, they are manifesting the Shekinah. And the Shekinah is the feminine part of God. This is the spirit that was hovering over the waters when everything was created and manifested thing. That is why the earth is really a feminine thing. Mother Earth. Mater is mother in Latin. Materialism, the thing that is manifested. So that is why the earth really belongs to the feminine principle. And that is why there is so much trouble going on now, because it's a patriarchal, it's a masculine world more or less, and have been for hundreds of years now. So now we need not to throw out the masculine, but to work in equality. That is why Mary the Magdalene's archetype is coming in now. This is the best answer I can give you about all this. I can talk from now on, and to, so I better leave it here, you know. But it is very interesting. I'm very much into it. Maybe we should, if this is the last question or...
So you're talking about Shem and alignment and finding your purpose. And I'm just thinking if you can elaborate a little bit about what is actually the purpose of the bodily experience? Why are we here?
As I said earlier on, to me, the New Testament is the scripture I more and more tend to read, you know, because my Father's kingdom have many mansions. And wherever we incarnate, we are ambassadors of the creative principle that wants to experience something more. You know, when we say that the earth and everything was created millions of years ago, we ought to think that this is something that stopped at that time. We are still in that process. Everything that came from that center or however it happened, are on its way in every direction from that center, and it's still. We are still in that moon. And I see it like this. This is God exhaling. And at one point he needs to inhale. And then everything comes back to where it all started. So this is what they also knew in the old mystery schools. Everything must return to its source at some time. Everything we sense out will also return to us, good or bad. So this is why we are incarnated, and that is why we are in a bodily incarnation. That is, we are here to experience as ambassadors for the creative principle. What to us is millions of years maybe here on Earth is just a tiny split second in the whole creation. So for us, you know, we think, but how long shall this be? I mean, we just started, you know. So, welcome to the ride. A last question or something before we...
We have one question from Line Andersen. What to do if you have a deep feeling that Yeshua wants to work through you? What to do if you have the feeling, you have a deep feeling that Yeshua wants to work through you?
What you do?
Mm-hmm.
You
what
open
can
your
you, do?
You open your doors and welcome him in, of course. That's the only thing. Mm-hmm. Thank you for coming, and I hope this was a little inspiration in your own work. Thank you.